It's a big honor to be here today. So I would like to talk about from GWAS to function, and I'm basically in the context of insomnia and intelligence. But before I do so, I would like to sketch a little bit what we do in my group, and so you have a bit more context of the kind of research that I will be talking about today. So my title is From GWAS to Function, and that's basically what we are doing also in our department. So we start with GWAS and we end with function. And then in between, there's a lot of different steps. So this is just a schematic overview, but I think you can draw many of these overviews, but this is how I see the research that we do. So we start with GWAS, which is mostly gene discovery. And then we continue with gene interpretation. And then we do functional testing. We search for cellular phenotype. And then in the end, of course, that's proving causation and finding a treatment or finding a pill for IQ or for any disease that we're interested in. And in any stage, we are also focusing on method development. My background is in statistical genetics, so I'm really interested in developing novel methods. And I think in this time, where it's a really exciting time, where all the large data sets are coming in from biology, but also bioinformatics, and from all the psychiatric phenotypes that we have, combining all these data into meaningful data sets that we can use to interpret our output, I think that's a big challenge, and that's why part of our work that we do also focuses on the development of novel methods to deal with these novel data that comes about. So we usually start with a data set, and we collaborate with 23andMe. It's a wonderful company, but also with UK Biobank, and we're also involved in many of the large-scale consortia where we obtain our data from and also contribute some of the data that we've collected ourselves. And I've also I'm also providing a cluster computer to the whole genetic research community, which I bought a couple of years ago, but I made it available to everyone who's working in genetics to have access free of any charges to use cluster computer power to run their genetic analysis, because I think that's a basic requirement for people working in genetics. And then after we've run a GWAS, starts the first phase of extensive functional annotation. Now, this sounds like a very easy thing to do. You have your Manhattan plot, your GWAS results, nice p-values, and then you start looking up in a database, what does this SNP do, what gene is involved, where's this gene expressed? And it used to be simple like that at a time when we didn't have so much information available, but it's gotten much more complex, and you need much more knowledge about all the different bioinformatic resources that are out there. So we recently developed a platform that collects all of these data from all the different resources. It doesn't really do any analysis, this platform. It simply collects all the data. So it allows you to upload your GWAS summary statistics, and you get a huge amount of output that helps you interpret and also visualize your GWAS output. And that platform is called FUMA, so we usually use this platform, but FUMA uses NLVAR and all the other tools that are available as well. So we build on other people's wonderful ideas with this. Now, the outcome of this process over here, ideally, is a hypothesis. It generates hypothesis that can be actually tested in a functional experiment. So, for example, we can come up with a hypothesis that says this gene is associated with IQ, and we've seen that higher expression of this gene is associated with a SNP variant that's also associated with higher intelligence score, for example. So we have a direction of effect, and that direction of effect can directly be tested. And there's multiple other things that follow from these that are ready to be tested in a functional experiment. Now, functional experiment also used to be very simple when we were only looking at monogenic diseases. So monogenic disease, there's only one gene involved. Once you are lucky enough to find that gene, then it's quite straightforward what you should do in a functional follow-up. You can, for example, build a knockout mouse where you knock out that gene, and then you can test for all of the differences that you see happening in that mouse at the cellular level, at the behavior level, and that's fairly easy. But with complex trait genetics, most of the traits are highly polygenic. So there's not one gene involved, there's thousands of genes involved. And all of these genes have very little effects. So it doesn't really make a lot of sense to spend 10 years of your time knocking out all of these genes at a time in a knockout model. So classical functional follow-up is not very handy to use in a polygenic context. There might still be some uses, but just to prove that a gene is involved in a disorder, it's not something you will be able to do with a knockout model. So we need some different techniques. And in our lab, we use iPSC models, we use mouse models, and cellomics. iPSC models is based on stem cell biology. So you can take a little bit of skin or a hair from an individual. You put some chemistry, or I usually call it magic because I'm not a stem cell biologist, but you put some chemistry in there, some factors that make the cells go back into a pluripotent state. And from there on, you can differentiate them into any type of cell that you would like, and including neurons and glia cells. So if we're interested in brain diseases, then you can actually take skin cells from a schizophrenia patient, for example, or from a person with high intelligence, and then grow them into a mini brain in the lab, and then have a mini brains from people with high intelligence or with low intelligence, and compare them on different cellular phenotypes. Now, this sounds very ideal, of course, and there's a lot of limitations still with these methods, which are fairly new. But I think this is a quite promising opportunity for functional follow-up in the context of polygenic traits where multiple genes are involved, and it's not really easy to make a knockout model. We also use some mouse models. If we find that a certain set of genes is important, and we know that that set of genes is involved in a certain pathway, then we can manipulate that pathway in the mouse model and also see what the consequences are on the behavior of that mouse, for example. And then we use cellomics using high content screening, where we can up or down regulate multiple genes at the same time and look at cellomics factors like morphology of a cell or how it makes connections to other cells. So this is also something that you can use if there's more than one gene involved. So these are all different ways of functionally following up the results that we obtain from GWAS and annotation of that. Now, let's say we've succeeded in doing this and we've actually found a functional readout for schizophrenia or any phenotype that we're interested in. Then, of course, the next step is to actually prove that that functional readout or that mechanism that you think you found for your trait is actually causally related to your disorder. And that's the final step, to prove causation. And there's multiple ways of doing this. I only listed these two now. So one thing you can do is to see whether if you have this functional readout, you test one of the drugs that you think might help, and then the function that you thought was impaired is suddenly rescued. So that would be one way of proving one step in the causality process. But of course, the final step will be to prove causation in a patient. So what would happen if you have this drug treatment here and you would give it to a patient? Would that actually solve the disease? So that's actually the last step in proving causation. And there's some other step. I mean, this is a really much larger thing over here, and I only listed these two because these are things that we can actually do in our lab, but there's multiple ways of doing this. So this is the whole process that we're currently working on in my group, and it actually involves a lot of people from different backgrounds, people from statistics and psychiatry, but also stem cell biologists, and we have some mathematicians. So it's a lot of interdisciplinary research going on. And I think that's something that we need in these times where so much data is coming out and so many nice and reliable results are coming out. We cannot just simply stay in our own little room in our own discipline. We need to talk to people from other disciplines and look beyond our own knowledge and learn from that, I think. So today I will be talking about insomnia and intelligence, and those two traits are actually in the gene discovery and interpretation phase. I will not be able to talk about schizophrenia, depression, migraine, and Rett syndrome, which are also very exciting projects that are ongoing in my lab, where we're currently at this phase, where we're building little brains, little organoids for schizophrenia patients and controls, and actually testing what is the functional readout for schizophrenia, but also for depression and for a very interesting disease called Rett syndrome. So today will be about novel results that we found for insomnia and intelligence. So insomnia is a highly prevalent disorder in the population. It's about having problems falling asleep and also staying asleep. It's an increasing public health problem. It has a prevalence of around 30%, and it's known to have negative effects on health. We also know from previous twin and family studies that there's a genetic factor involved, so it makes sense to look for genes that are important for insomnia. And up until 2017, there were only a couple of candidate gene studies. There was hardly any replication, and there were no genome-wide association studies for insomnia. So in 2017, two genome-wide association studies were published, and one was from our group, which was the largest, including more than 100,000 individuals. We detected three genetic loci for insomnia, and we found a very important role, actually the most important gene over here with a very, very large peak was for the MEIS1 gene. And this gene had already been found to be associated with restless leg syndrome, which is another insomnia-related disorder. So it was a very likely candidate to be involved in insomnia. So after we published this study, we decided, this is an interesting study, but we need to find out a little bit more because we only found three genetic loci and we didn't really find all the genes that were associated with insomnia. So we set up a follow-up study with the aim to obtain more insight into the genetic architecture of insomnia, to also obtain more insight into the underlying biological pathways, and also to generate hypotheses for functional follow-up. We used two large data sets to obtain data. The first one was from the UK Biobank, which I think you're all familiar with. It's a very sympathetic initiative in the UK Biobank where any researchers can, in principle, obtain access to, paying just a very small fee. It currently includes 500,000 individuals. And we teamed up with 23andMe because they also had information on insomnia, which was very similar to the information that we had available in the UK Biobank. And this is a schematic overview of all the analysis that we did. I will not have time to discuss every output and also not in detail how we did things, but I'd be happy to discuss that during the break, for example. So we obtained the two GWASs, then did a meta-analysis for insomnia, obtained the SNP p-values, and then did all the functional annotation and pathway analysis with that. We looked at biological pathways, we looked at tissue enrichment and single cell enrichment. We also looked at genetic correlations and also did a Mendelian randomization analysis where you can actually say something about direction of causation between insomnia and other traits. So I will briefly touch upon some of the highlights that came out of these results. So this is our main outcome. And we were able to obtain insomnia information for 1.3 million individuals. And to the best of my knowledge, this is so far the largest GWAS to date, but these numbers are increasing rapidly. So there might already be another GWAS out there that we've missed. But this is when I started my PhD, I was working with a sample of 600 individuals, which at that time I thought was a huge sample. But I can't imagine the PhD students working today, and I'm really jealous of them when they have their hands in data sets like this with 1.3 million individuals. And with such a sample size, of course, there were a lot of significant hits. We had almost 12,000 genome-wide significant SNPs. They were represented by 248 lead SNPs and 202 independent risk loci for insomnia. From all of these GWAS SNPs, there were 71 missense mutations. Now, these SNPs are one of the most interesting findings, I think, because these are SNPs that actually alter the protein structure of a gene. So that means that they are directly translatable. You can directly use them for functional follow-up because they have a very good hypothesis that you can actually test. Now, what was a little bit disappointing was the SNP-based heritability, which was only 7%. And that can either mean that the sample is underpowered still, but that's a very unlikely explanation in this case, or it means that there's a lot of, for example, non-additive interaction going on, or maybe there's a lot of very rare variants that we did not include, although we did include some of the rare variants. I think our cutoff was 0.01% for minor allele frequency, but there might be even rarer variants that are involved in insomnia. So this is the second most significant risk loci that I wanted to show you. It's the only locus that I will show you, just to illustrate what we did with every risk locus. So here we see all the significantly associated SNPs, and then also the LD structure with all the surrounding SNPs. So what we did using the FUMA platform with this is to look up what are the significant SNPs doing. So are they located inside of a gene? That's something everyone looks at for the first time. But we also checked whether the significant SNPs were somehow regulating genes outside of the risk locus, or whether they were involved in a chromatin interaction model link. So if you have a significant SNP, and it's not in a gene, but it's known to interact with a gene somewhere else due to chromatin interaction, due to folding of the DNA, then that SNP might actually influence the expression of a gene outside of the risk locus. So we annotated every SNP with that kind of information. And in this risk locus, the three genes that came out as most likely being causal for insomnia were the three red genes over here. And they were, as you see, these two genes are actually outside of this risk locus, and they were implicated by EQTL associations. So there were links that were influencing the expression of these genes. So we did, this is what we call EQTL mapping. So we mapped SNPs to genes when they influence expression of those genes. And we also mapped SNPs to genes when we knew that there was a DNA interaction going on between the SNPs. So that's what we call chromatin interaction gene mapping. And then we also mapped genes because there were SNPs located right inside of the gene. And that's what we call positional gene mapping. And then there's a fourth way of implicating genes, and that's a statistical gene-based test. So we conducted all four of these methods, and then all of these methods will implicate different genes, but there were 62 genes that were implicated by all four methods. So these genes are very highly likely to actually be involved in insomnia. The other genes might also be very interesting, but they not necessarily have to be implicated by all four methods. Now, this is another Manhattan plot using the gene-based test statistic. And there's almost 1,000 genes that came out significantly associated here. I only highlighted the names of the top 15. And again, we found the MEIS1 gene, which was also found in that first genome-wide association study for insomnia. But we also found this gene over here, which had never been associated with insomnia in humans before, but it's a gene that has been found in mouse studies to regulate the sleep-wake cycle. So that's a very likely candidate also to be involved in insomnia. And then I just wanted to highlight two genes that were interesting because of some other reason. So this is the MEIS1 gene again, which I mentioned before. And this one is actually interesting because it was in this risk locus over here. That was the most associated risk locus. But there's another independent risk locus lying right next to this, but it's LD independent from this risk locus. But SNPs over here that are significantly associated with insomnia interact with the MEIS1 gene again. So there's evidence from two independent risk loci pointing towards the same gene. And the same happened with this gene over here, which was also implicated by two different risk loci, but also by multiple gene mapping strategies. So it had EQTL association, positional, there were genome-wide significant SNPs in it from two different risk loci. There were chromatin interactions. So that's a very interesting gene also to pick up when you're interested in doing functional follow-up. We continued with doing gene set analysis, and I will not discuss the gene ontology sets very much in detail, but I would like to point out the tissue type gene set analysis that we did, because here we looked at whether the significant genes were enriched for expression in a certain tissue type, and our most strongly associated tissue type were the basal ganglia. So we decided to zoom in on that a little bit by looking at cell type expression, where you can actually look at specific cell types and see whether expression of your significant genes for insomnia are more highly or are more lowly expressed in that particular cell type. And we found only one particular cell type that was significantly associated with insomnia. Now, that cell type happens to be in the basal ganglia. In fact, 95% of the basal ganglia cells are medium spiny neuron cell types. So these two make a lot of sense. And then if we combine all this information, then this is the current model based on the GWAS knowledge that we have for insomnia. Based on the tissue gene sets, there's a role for these different tissue, but mostly for the basal ganglia. And then for the cell type gene set, there's a role for especially the medium spiny neurons in the basal ganglia. Now, from mouse knockout studies, we know that several of these tissues are involved in the sleep-wake cycle, but we haven't seen that yet in humans. So the next step will be to make a cell model or to generate a brain model, a human brain model, based, for example, on stem cell biology, and to actually test whether connections between these different tissue types or whether these specific cell types, what do they do, what is their role in insomnia? So this will be a very directed way of doing functional follow-up. So one last thing that we did with insomnia, and which is mostly the reason why I'm interested in insomnia, is to look at the association of insomnia with other traits, other brain-related traits. And I forgot to put the asterisks to tell you which ones are significantly different from zero, but these are the genetic correlations, and the ones on the top and the ones on the bottom are significantly associated with insomnia. And we found that there was a very strong association with these psychiatric phenotypes. So when we saw this, we conducted the Mendelian randomization, where you can test whether there's a direct causal effect of insomnia on your psychiatric trait, or vice versa, or whether there's bidirectional causation. And these are some of the highlights that we found. We found a direct causal risk effect of insomnia on metabolic syndrome phenotypes, a bidirectional association with educational attainment, NIQ, and insomnia, and causal risk effects on several psychiatric traits. So these are very interesting, and I think they, so if we dig into the neurobiological mechanism of insomnia a little bit further, that will also give us some more insight of these psychiatric traits. So that's why I'm mainly interested in this phenotype. Okay, so the next thing I wanted to tell you, that was insomnia. But I also wanted to tell you something about intelligence, because that's such a human trait, although, of course, there's a lot of animals that we also think have some level of intelligence. But this is one of my major interests. And so we published a large GWAS4 intelligence last year using a sample of 78,000 individuals. And for the first time, we were able to reliably detect 18 different loci that were involved in intelligence. And well, I mean, that was really nice, but it still were only 18 loci, and we could still explain a small proportion of the variance in intelligence or cognitive ability. So the main goal of the current study was to increase this sample size further and to detect a little bit more and to understand a little bit more about the underlying neurobiology. So we reached out to the broader community, and we were able to collect data from many different groups around the world. I will not go into this in too much detail, but there were a lot of cohorts that were included in this new GWAS study, and the average genetic correlation between the cohorts was 0.63, which is not too high. We would have loved to see a much higher correlation, and this indicates that there might be some differences in the way intelligence was measured between the different cohorts, but it's still quite substantial, so it does warrant doing a meta-analysis. And these were our results for almost 280,000 individuals. We had more than 12,000 genome-wide significant SNPs, and there were 206 independent loci. We replicated most of the loci that we previously found. There were also some loci that were no longer significant now. And there were 41 missense mutations. So these, again, are the ones that alter the protein structure and that can be used directly in a functional follow-up test. Our SNP heritability was 18%, which is more or less what we found in previous studies. And we could predict, using polygenic score risk prediction in an independent sample, a little bit more than 5% of the variation in intelligence. Now, this is quite high for intelligence, but it's still a very low percentage. And that means that if you look at someone's DNA, it's very difficult to predict that person's IQ score with the knowledge that we currently have. I think this might increase. So I think in the next 5 years, we will have a much higher prediction score. But with current knowledge, it's still very difficult to do this prediction based on DNA. So one thing we did was to partition the SNP-based heritability. So we looked at where is the heritability of IQ residing, in what kind of SNPs. And we found that most of the heritability was in conserved regions. That's something that you find for most of the brain-related traits. But what you don't find for most of the brain-related traits is an enrichment of heritability in coding regions. That's really particular for IQ. I haven't seen that with schizophrenia or depression or migraine. So this was a very intriguing finding. And of course, this also relates back to the missense mutations that we saw in the previous slide. Now, there were a lot of genes implicated, but there were 15 genes that were implicated by two loci. So there was multiple roots of evidence pointing towards these genes. And especially this gene over here, there was a lot of evidence from different sources pointing at that gene. And so for every gene in this study, we have this kind of information. And this is the gene-based Manhattan plot. And again, for intelligence, there's thousands of genes or hundreds of genes involved. So that makes it, I mean, it's a nice result. If you would have asked me how many genes would be involved in IQ 15 years ago, then I would have said, oh, it's a lot of genes. It's like 20 genes or so. But it's actually more than 1,000 of genes. It's a huge amount of genes, and that's nice, but it's also a challenge for us to interpret this result, of course. And I will say a little bit more about it later on. So we also ran a gene set analysis. We found some interesting gene sets related to neurogenesis and mostly central nervous system. Of course, that's something that's not unexpected. Intelligence is something that resides in the brain, and so this was basically confirming what we already knew. And our tissue enrichment analysis also found enrichment in brain tissue mostly. And we also, like with insomnia, conducted a single cell expression analysis. Again, we found the medium spiny neurons, but we also found two other cell types that are of interest to intelligence. So if you want to make, if you want to generate neurons in an IQ context, then these are the type of neurons that I would advise you to generate, because these are the ones that are most likely to be causally or to be associated with intelligence. Now, one of the last things we did was to look at genetic correlations, and we found a very strong correlation with educational attainment, which is not unexpected, but I think a nice outcome from this study was a significant negative correlation with Alzheimer's disease. So the genes that are associated with higher intelligence are also associated with a lower risk for Alzheimer's disorder. And then Mendelian randomizations showed some nice causal or bidirectional effects. So bidirectional effect with educational attainment. So intelligence is causally related to educational attainment, but also the other way around. So it's bidirectional. And the same is true for schizophrenia. But the strongest effect was a protective effect of intelligence on schizophrenia. We also found a protective effect on ADHD and Alzheimer's disease, and we found a risk effect of cognitive ability on autism. And that might be because the people that were inside our study, so it's higher cognitive ability is associated with a lower risk for autism. So that might be related to the type of autism people that were included in the study. Okay, so wrapping up, this is what I started off with, and this is currently where we are with insomnia and intelligence. I would love to be a little bit further over here, and maybe in 5 years I would like to be here, but we're currently setting up research to do this here. I'm trying to get some grant money to work on this, to generate iPSC models for insomnia and intelligence, to be able to make organoids for highly intelligent people versus low intelligent people. I know it's a sensitive topic. I'm not interested in any things that make this a sensitive topic, but I'm interested in understanding the underlying neurobiology of this, and maybe to be able to say something about the traits that are correlated to intelligence. So this is something that we're currently setting up, and hopefully in a couple of years we will have some new results for this. So those are my next step, to work on those functional readouts, to be able to discover a functional readout, and ultimately to move towards treatment and maybe manipulate some of these traits. And this is part of the group that I work with. Those were all the people that were involved with insomnia and intelligence. And these are some of my main collaborators outside of the group. Well, thanks for your attention.